Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Friday's protest rallies in Syria dedicated to its free women. In Egypt, support for unity and the Palestinian cause. And in Bahrain, a day of sacred defense. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
Twin suicide bombings targeted a security training base in northeastern Pakistan, killing 80 people and injuring over 140 others. The attacks carried the hallmark of Pakistan's Taliban movement in what seems to be the first retaliatory act for the killing of Al-Qaeda leader Osama bin Laden. The movement warned of more bloodshed in what it referred to as the launch of massive attacks in Pakistan and Afghanistan. Our correspondent, Mahyoub Khudr, reports from Islamabad.
It's a bloody message of vengeance delivered by the Taliban. The victims were mostly paramilitary recruits in the city of Charsala. They were targeted by twin suicide attacks as they prepared for a 10-day leave of absence to visit their families. The Taliban said the attacks were the first acts of revenge for the killing of the Al-Qaeda leader Osama bin Laden and warned of more attacks to come.
This area, which is Charsada, this is
the area of Charsada is adjacent to the Mohmand tribal region, and a military operation is underway. It's obvious that the Taliban suicide bombers were able to infiltrate Mohmand to launch their attacks. The government will have no choice but to scale back its military action due to the fear of more bloody retaliatory attacks.
The fear of revenge for the death of bin Laden turned into a frightening reality following the Charsada attacks. The message here is that the death of bin Laden will have repercussions. Meanwhile, the opposition and public continue to mount pressure on Prime Minister Yousef Ridha Gilani and his government in an attempt to topple it. It seems that a new political crisis in the country is unfolding in the context of the authorities' grave failure to protect the nation's sovereignty.
It's very fluid.
The political situation in the country is very volatile, amid the public and opposition's persistence to topple the government. It's highly expected that political surprises will unfold in the coming days. In order to avoid any problems, the government will likely offer concessions in the Chamber of Parliament, most notably by modifying its strategy in the war on terror.
The death of bin Laden did not only explode the internal front, but also put U.S.-Pakistani relations under scrutiny, especially amid the mistrust revealed by both sides. While Islamabad is warning the U.S. of similar attacks on its soil without notice, Washington is demanding the names of military officials accused of protecting bin Laden, who are jeopardizing intelligence cooperation between the two countries. The ramifications of bin Laden's death on Pakistani soil are continuing to cast shadows on both internal and external fronts. Internally, pressure is mounting on Gilani's government, which seems to be headed towards uncertainty. Mahyoub Khudr, Dubai TV, Islamabad.
Italian Foreign Minister Franco Frattini said that the International Criminal Court is likely to issue an international arrest warrant to the Libyan leader Muammar al-Gaddafi at the end of the month. Frattini expects another warrant to be issued to a number of officials in his regime and perhaps some of his family members. On the ground, the Libyan Transitional Council announced that opposition forces managed to take control of Misurata and its surrounding areas.
As soon as they succeeded in seizing control of Misurata Airport, the armed opposition fighters in Libya began to push west towards Zantan City, with their minds on the capital, Tripoli. Nearly every day, Tripoli is bombed by NATO airstrikes. Libyan authorities said that the last airstrike launched approximately 10 missiles, killing three people and wounding dozens.
عشرة ملايين دولار صرفت لكي يضرب هذا المكان الآمن.
Tens of millions of dollars were spent to strike this safe place where children play. Just a few meters from here, a children's playground and an amusement park were hit. Not far from that is an administrative building that was hit.
مباني إدارية ضربت.
Not far from the capital, the Libya-Tunisia border witnessed new clashes between the armed opposition fighters and Colonel Gaddafi's loyalist forces. The fighting resumed in this area, the surroundings of the Dahiba crossing, which the opposition took control of late last month. Under these circumstances, Libyan civilians find themselves caught between gunfire from both sides as they try to cross the border into Tunisia. Most refugees are coming from the city of Zantan near the border, which many describe as a war zone.
Two people from Zantan, of course. They were hit in the abdomen by fragments of mortar shells during clashes in Zantan. Both were hit in the abdomen.
In Zantan, opposition fighters are requesting that NATO provide them with more advanced weaponry that will enable them to continue fighting against the colonel's forces that have been besieging the city from three directions and bombing it with heavy artillery shells.
We need support to defeat these battalions. The weapons that we have now are part of the loot we seized from Gaddafi's battalions.
Even though Tripoli is not witnessing fighting, but only shelling, the pressure on Gaddafi seems to be escalating amid reports of anti-regime demonstrations in a number of the city's neighborhoods in the last few days. Mohammed Rida, BBC.
Mohammed Rida, BBC.
في الوقت الذي شهدت فيه عدة مدن سورية اليوم مظاهرات بعد صلاة الجمعة في إطار ما سمي ب
A number of Syrian cities witnessed demonstrations after Friday prayers in the framework of what is called the Friday of Free Women. The Syrian Minister of Information, Adnan Hassan Mahmoud, said that Syria will conduct a national dialogue in various parts of the country in the coming days. In this context, activists said that the death toll has risen to 850, a number the UN said seemed realistic. Two demonstrators were killed in today's protest in Homs. Rights sources said that four women were killed several days ago in Markab village near Banias.
قبل أيام في قرية المرقب القريبة من بنياس.
The army stormed us, arrested us, and the Shabiha attacked us. God is great.
In honor of these women, activists call for a Friday of Free Women demonstration to lead Syria towards freedom and only freedom. Their shouts were not weak because of the pain endured in a country where brothers are killing each other. They were eyewitnesses of Ash-Shabiha's aggression on residents in Markab village of Banias. These images were taken on May 7th. In the current Syrian environment, it takes a long time for videos to be viewed after breaking through the media and security siege. Officially, the emergency law has been lifted for weeks, and President Bashar al-Assad ordered forces not to fire on protesters. Then who was responsible for the orders to kill this woman? She is one of the four women who came out in Markab village to demand the release of detainees. They were not infiltrators, nor did they possess any explosives or guns. They only demanded the freedom of others and were deprived of the right to live. Another bitter reality that the imprisoned women are suffering from is being accused of having a different opinion. According to a statement by the Friends of Humanity organization headquartered in Vienna, the authorities arbitrarily arrested 16 female opposition figures and activists in the latest protests. Suhair al-Atasi, Fida Horani, and Dana Jawabra are among the protesters described as the free women, even if they are behind bars. The Friends of Humanity statement adds that 8 women were killed by the security forces' gunfire. 8 weeks have passed since Daraa, Hama, Banias, Homs, Deir ez-Zor, and other cities defied the myth that the regime here is solid above all tremors. Syria has paid a high price for the weeks of protests. According to human rights activists, 850 people have been killed so far. The United Nations says this number seems realistic. During the Syrian protests, some women were killed or imprisoned, and everyone who came out on the Friday of Free Women vowed to honor their courage.
As we mentioned, a number of Syrian cities witnessed protests today after Friday prayers in response to activists' call for marches across Syria called the Friday of the Free Women. These are video clips from the Zahira neighborhood in Damascus.
كثفت قوى الأمن البحرينية وقوات الاحتلال السعودي انتشارها في أغلب مناطق البحرين مع انطلاق المسيرات الاحتجاجية عقب صلاة الجمعة.
Bahraini forces and Saudi occupation forces were deployed across Bahrain in anticipation of protests following Friday prayers. Our Al Alam correspondent reported that 2 large marches took place in Karzahan and Al Diya. Both marches witnessed heavy military reinforcement. These forces shut down streets and fired at protesters. In addition, they stormed the center of the area and launched an arrest campaign against the participating youth. Our correspondent added that the youth of the revolution faced Bahraini and Saudi occupation forces with their bare chests and announced the launch of the sacred defense phase. In addition, a march in the village of Ali was suppressed.
فصول لا تنتهي من انتهاك المقدسات منذ قمع الاحتجاجات المطالبة بالإصلاحات السياسية في البحرين من قبل
Endless chapters of violations against sacred sites continue since Saudi-backed Bahraini forces cracked down on demonstrations demanding political reforms in Bahrain. Meanwhile, the campaign against protesters continues. The youth of the February 14th revolution assigned this Friday as the Day of Sacred Defense, initiating a new phase in the protest movement. However, early this morning, Bahraini and Saudi forces stormed the mosque of Imam al-Sadiq, peace be upon him, in the capital Manama's Dadias area, where central Friday prayers are held. The forces' corruption was displayed before they arrested a youth while others managed to flee. According to eyewitnesses, the forces first broke the mosque doors without showing any respect for the sanctity of the site. Then they entered after beating a Pakistani worker at the mosque. As they've done in the past, the forces again threw copies of the Holy Quran and Muslim prayer books on the floor. Then they threw a stun grenade close to Sheikh Isa Qasim and proceeded to steal 3 televisions and audio devices. The violation of sanctities is accompanied by a violation of dignity, freedom, and rights. كما لم يتوقف مسلسل فصل الموظفين على خلفية مشاركة في الاحتجاجات السلمية. The crackdown continues as additional employees are being fired for having participated in peaceful demonstrations. 60 employees from the Alba company were most recently affected by this series of layoffs.
من رؤساء الوحدات العلاجية في المستشفيات دون معرفة الأسباب. القبضة الحديدية.
Meanwhile, the authorities suspended 4 doctors for 3 months. Without providing a reason. The brutal crackdown did not prevent protesters from peacefully taking to the street to condemn the authorities' systematic campaign to destroy mosques and religious sites and incite sectarian strife.
العشرات ساروا في شوارع منطقة المعامير في مسيرة احتجاجية مؤكدين على التمسك بالوحدة.
Dozens marched on the streets of Ma'amir, confirming their commitment to unity between the various sects of Bahraini society and to working together for attaining their political, economic, and social demands. They also appealed to Islamic countries to support them in confronting the cleansing campaign that is being waged by the authorities with the backing of Saudi occupation forces. It seems that they still have not learned the Egyptian-Tunisian lesson.
ها
Hundreds of Jordanians have taken to the streets of the capital demanding a sovereign Palestinian state and the right of Palestinian refugees to return to their homeland. Demonstrators marched in downtown Amman calling for the Israeli ambassador to be sent home, chanting slogans in support of the Palestinian cause. The rally was organized to mark the anniversary of the creation of Israel on May 15, 1948. The day is dubbed Nakba, or the Day of Catastrophe. Jordan hosts the largest number of Palestinian refugees. More casualties are reported from Yemen as regime forces open fire on protesters in several cities. Massive rallies have been held nationwide on Friday despite a heavy-handed government response. Four people were killed, dozens wounded in Ib, and a number of others were injured in Taiz when regime forces opened fire on the crowds. The deaths of dozens of protesters over the past 2 days have further inflamed public sentiment. Protesters want embattled President Ali Abdullah Saleh to leave, but addressing his supporters in the capital, Sana'a, Saleh said he has no intention of stepping down. He also warned that the military would be sent to confront the opposition if necessary. However, the opposition have vowed to march on the government buildings to force Saleh out of office. Elsewhere in the news, hundreds of protesters in the eastern city of Awamiya in Saudi Arabia have taken to the streets despite the heavy military presence there. Protesters are demanding an end to what they call the occupation of Bahrain. They're also calling on the Saudi regime to release all prisoners of conscience. The prisoners have been detained by the thousands, calling for political reform. In Saudi Arabia, all public protests are prohibited, but despite the ban, many protests have taken place over the past several months, mostly in support of the Bahraini revolution. Meanwhile, the Saudi government has banned mass prayers for Palestinians on Friday in the capital, Riyadh.
تفاصيل النشرة. تحت مسمى مليونية جمعة الوحدة الوطنية وأمن المواطن احتشدت جموع غفيرة في
Under the banner of the Friday of Millions for National Unity and the Safety of the Citizen, a large number of people gathered in Tahrir, or Liberation Square. They confirmed the importance of the Egyptian people's unity and the union of Muslims and Copts, who represent the two wings of the country. Protesters called on the Egyptian people to reject sectarian strife and combat its instigators who are trying to thwart the January 25th revolution. In addition, they demanded a rush to the prosecution of the former regime's figureheads, most importantly that of former President Hosni Mubarak. The protests that come amid heightened security measures also called for supporting the Palestinian cause. Some demonstrators chanted slogans demanding the Palestinian refugees' right of return to their lands. In addition, they stressed their support for a third Palestinian intifada or uprising. A large number of Arabs living in Egypt participated in the protest. Today's rally comes in response to a call by a number of groups, including the Coordinating Committee for the Revolution's Masses. The committee includes the Coalition of the Youth Revolution, the Muslim Brotherhood, the National Organization for Change, the Revolution's Board of Trustees, the Alliance of Egypt's Revolutionaries, the Coalition of Free Egypt, and the Committee of Independent Academics, in addition to some independent national figures.
Just like the old saying, the nation is like one body. If any part complains, the rest will stay awake in fever. Egyptians marked the Friday of National Unity in Tahrir Square. They raised banners and chanted slogans in support of unity, reaffirming that Egypt is one united nation. They also accused certain groups of trying to disrupt the country's security.
Our country is beautiful and does not tolerate sectarian strife. The Egyptian people, Muslims and Christians alike, have been united throughout history. The Mohammed Najib revolution was launched, toppling King Farouk. This was followed by the Saad Zaghloul revolution and the revolution of July 23, 1952.
We are all brothers. We are the people of Egypt. We are all brothers. Some troublemakers are trying to take the country back to what it was nearly 5 months ago. The situation will improve. This requires that both Muslims and Christians work together.
The Friday of National Unity highlighted Arab unity across the Arab world, as many protesters waved the Palestinian flag, reaffirming that Palestine is a national plight rooted in the hearts of Egyptians.
I came to Tahrir Square today to express support for the Palestinian cause. The plight of the Palestinian people is also ours. There's no difference between what's happening in Palestine, Libya, or Iraq. We can't ignore the Palestinian or Arab plight. We are one united nation. I'm also talking about what's happening in Tahrir Square.
This is the best display of national unity witnessed in Tahrir Square since the launch of the January 25th revolution. Everyone here knows with certainty that Egypt will remain united and intact, and that the Palestinian plight will not be ignored by the Egyptian people. Mohammed Jamal, Nile TV.
Here in Israel, the right-wing student group Im Tirtzu has launched a campaign aimed at discrediting what it calls a narrative of myths and lies regarding Arab education regarding the founding of the State of Israel. The group has published a 70-page booklet entitled Nakba Charta, which translates into the catastrophe nonsense and slang, written by one of Im Tirtzu's leaders, Erez Tad Moore, and Ma'ariv newspaper journalist Arye Segal. The pamphlet exposes what it claims is a list of lies that threatens to drown Israel like a tsunami by promoting the global delegitimization of the Jewish state. The booklet is being distributed outside universities and public institutions. The campaign is slated to include various demonstrations across the country. Despite today's skirmishes marking Nakba Day, the incidents were less violent than many had predicted. IBA's Eli Wogelenter spoke to the co-director of the Israel-Palestine Center for Research and Information, as well as being a member of the Palestine National Council, Hanna Signora, as well as Professor Mohammed Dejani of Al-Quds University, about the day that the Palestinians call the Day of Catastrophe.
They would like to commemorate the Nakba so that it will remain in the memory, and that it would revive the Palestinian issue and support the right of the Palestinians to a Palestinian state in the future.
Do you see demonstrations, violent demonstrations happening?
No, I don't think so.
Why not?
I think that so far the Palestinian movement has been the Palestinian protest movement has been a peaceful movement, and I don't see any reason for it to be violent or to resort to violence.
The Palestinian Authority has encouraged that even if there are demonstration or resistance, and if the occupation continues, it's going to be a nonviolent resistance. And I think this is what we will be pursuing as Palestinians in the occupied territories. And you could see the example happening in Belayn and other places and locations in Palestine.
How do you think that there will not be violence on this Nakba Day?
Because we have seen that both Fatah and Hamas are actually doing their utmost to tone down violence and to allow a kind of a period of no violence in order to help the peace process move forward.
American professor of international law Franklin Lamb asserted that the Syrian people and government have overcome the country's recent crisis. He said that the U.S. administration stands as one of the factors that triggered and funded the crisis. Lamb added in his interview with Syrian Satellite TV that the U.S. government has recently realized it will not benefit from chaos in Syria, even though that is what the U.S. was initially pursuing. He added that the Arab people and American people are both suffering. the Arabs suffer from Israel's occupation of their land, and the Americans suffer from Israel's political dependence on the U.S.
Why is the American embassy in Damascus issuing statements against Americans not to come to Damascus and demanding those who are in the city leave? This is another kind of tactic to weaken the Syrian economy and impair the tourism industry during peak season. I say this to my fellow Americans. Now is a great time to come to Syria because its green lands are flourishing and security prevails. You can take a stroll down the street at 2 a.m. If you do that in any of the 350 American cities, you'll see a big difference.
350 American cities, and you'll see a big difference. I predict that the American public, and I hope it's not violent.
Will begin to boycott Israel, maybe in a dramatic way, as they start to learn more and more of the truth. I won't be exaggerating by saying that the extent of the Israeli occupation of Palestine creates an occupation of our government in the U.S. Congress. Do I believe that the U.S. Congress really represents the Americans? No. It was bought and paid for by the Zionists. Therefore, the American people's struggle is connected with the Syrian and Palestinian people's struggle. You want to liberate the Arab land of Palestine, and we Americans have got to liberate our government and restore our principles so that we don't have an enemy in the Middle East.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Fire Doll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows, and more at linktv.org/mosaic. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.